It's all relative. Okay. Good morning. Today's daf is Samach Dalet. We're going to start on the first line of Samach Dalet. The beginning of Samach Dalet Amud Aleph is a little bit of a challenge, but not really. It looks like a challenge, but it's really not that bad. It's a throwback to something that we saw in Bameh Madlikin discussing the materials that are susceptible to Tum'ah. So on the surface, it might appear a little bit challenging, but I think that we will get through it really easily. So, Musaf Sak ala Beged, Shetameh Mishum Arig, was the quote from the Braita that we saw just a moment ago. Atu Beged Lav Arigu. Why does it say, in other words, in that Braita, it said that we add Sak shel, sak ala Beged. We add Sak. Sak is a coarser type of, it's goat hair material. We add that it's tameh mishum arig, that it's included in the category of beged, of clothing, and it's tameh mishum arig because it's woven. So atu beged lav arigu. Why does it mention specifically sak? Why does it mention specifically this goat hair material as a woven material? Are you telling me that regular beged is not also woven? Why do you have to tell me that sak is woven? So achi kamar, this is what it means to say musaf sak ala beged afal pisha eno arig tameh. What it means to say is that even though in general the types of begadim, the types of clothing and materials that are susceptible to tumah are fully woven together, when it comes to the goat hair material, it doesn't have to be fully woven together. Lemay chazi, what kind of situation would you have in which you would take goat hair not fully woven together and you would combine it into something useful? The answer is Amar Rabbi Yochanan Shekin Ani Kolea Shalosh Nimin V'Tole B'Tzavar Bito, because a poor person who doesn't have any ornament to put around his daughter's neck, he can't give her a necklace, he can't give her jewelry, so what he will do is he will take a few threads of the goat hair and he will dye them different colors, like you've seen, like little girls sometimes they wear, instead of real jewelry, they wear like a green or pink or something, so different colors, yeah, or beads. So they would put these hairs, they would twist them together kind of into like a makeshift necklace and dye them and put them around their neck as a type of necklace. So that type of arig, in other words, that's not a full arig, it's not fully woven together, but they are threads that are spun into thread. And then they're twisted together to make one entity. So they're braided together, you could say. So even though they are not fully woven together, it's still enough that it could be mekabel tum'ah. And that was what the Braita was saying, that it's considered mishum arig. It's considered to be a type of woven cloth, even if it's not fully woven. It's just braided together when it comes to this.
Rabbi, so, yeah. Question. And if it was not woven, it won't be...
If it's not combined at all, if it's just like three threads separate from each other. It has to be combined somehow. Right. It has to be combined somehow. Like Rashi says, it's lav arig mamash. Okay, but it has to be, it's not totally woven, but it has to be on some level combined. So it has to be at least twisted together or braided.
It's all the same material.
But it's all the same material, yeah.
Just a quick It gets too much.
Yeah, it does get tumah because even though it's not woven, woven with a needle, you know, completely, it's combined together.
Why it gets tumah? Because it's dead anymore?
Because it's not tameh by itself. What we're talking about is that in order for a shirt can become tameh if it touches a dead animal. If it touches dead animal. But it has to be, in other words, the clothing has to be considered complete clothing to be able to become tameh from something else. If you just have like a tuft of cotton or something like that and it touches the dead animal, the tuft of cotton is not going to become tameh because it's not anything. It has to be woven into something in order to be mekabel tumah. So now we're talking about when is it considered a beged? When is it considered to be clothing? Since this is not woven, is it considered clothing? So the answer is that it's a makeshift type of weaving and it counts. Yes?
Just a quick clarification. Mm-hmm. They're discussing tumah still within the context of what you can carry and what you cannot carry?
We're on a minor tangent right now.
We're on a minor tangent
because we
is no longer
because we started talking about tumah and we kind of went veered off
okay,
into
so
this issue.
But
we're
so
going to come
now
back.
It's fully the
now it's about tumah. We forgot about Shabbat for a few minutes.
Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah. So right now it's not going to deal with Shabbat for a minute. So Tanu Rabbanan, the rabbis taught sak in li elasak miyan li rabot etakil kaliv etachevek. So this is talking about We know that sack, that this kind of goat hair, this goat hair material that a person would wear, for example, shepherds would wear this out in the fields. They would wear this sack that we learned earlier in the Masechet a couple of dapim ago. So, but what about things that are also made from goat hair, but they're made for horses, such as the kilkili and the chavak, are various types of things that were that either held the saddle onto the horse or were otherwise attached to the animal to lead it, or whatever the purpose of it was. But the point was that it was a garment that was worn by the horse, not by a person. How do we know that these are also mikabel tum'ah, since they come from goat hair, and it's goat hair which is actually spun into thread and is actually woven, but it's not for a person to wear? Tamul Amar the Rabbi, the Torah teaches us osak, the extra word osak means not just sack that's worn, meaning goat hair material that's worn by a person, but even this goat hair material that's worn by an animal that perhaps is not quite as beautiful, not quite as finely done as that which is worn by a person, but still it's going to be mikabel tum'ah from the word osak. That's where we get it from. So yachol shani merabet ha-chavalim v'yata mishichot. What about a case where we just take fibers of goat hair? In other words, goat hair by itself. We haven't even spun it into thread. We haven't done anything to it. We just take it and we use it as a type of rope by itself, without doing anything, not processing it at all. Talmud Lomar, the Torah says, sak, it has to be sak masak tavoy ve'arig, afkol tavoy ve'arig. It has to be spun into thread and woven at some level. In other words, it can't just be the natural hair that you pluck off the hair off of the goat and you tie something with it. That's not going to be mekabel tumah, that piece of hair. It has to be spun into a thread, and it has to be at least woven or braided in some way for it to count. It could be woven and braided for a horse to wear, but it's got to be woven and braided for something. It can't just be a piece of hair. It says with regard to matmet, with regard to the impurity of the dead, v'chol kili or v'chol ma'ase izim, etc. Titchatau. It says that any kind of ma'ase izim, any kind of product made from goat hair, is subject to tumah. Lirabot the kilkeli v'yatachavak, which comes to include this type of goat hair clothing that's worn even by a horse, let's say, that's worn by an animal. And you might come and want to include also goat hair, even when it's not spun into thread and it's not made into any kind of fabric. Vidinu. And you'll tell me that it's logical, because tima basheret v'tima bamet. Ma kishtima basheret lo tima ela tavoy ve'arig. Af kishtima bamet lo tima ela tavoy ve'arig. You'll tell me logically it's impossible that you would take a piece of goat hair and say that it's mekabel tuma. Why? Because when we talked about regular tuma, which they call in the Talmud tuma sheret, ordinary tuma, we already said it has to be spun into thread and woven into something. So why would it be any different when it comes to tumat met? Why would it be any different when it comes to contracting tumah from a dead person? Obviously, for this article to be considered an article of clothing, it has to be spun and woven. It can't just be raw goat hair. So why do you have to tell me that? So im hekel. So what the Gemara says is that it should be logical. Lo tima ela tavoy ve'arik. Henim hekel b'tmesheret shehi kala. The answer is, but you might still say, wait a second, maybe why did we say before that goat hair that's unprocessed goat hair is not subject to tumah? Meaning, if you have just a piece of goat hair and it touches a dead rodent, okay, or it touches a cow that died without shechita, that it's not going to be, why is it not going to become tameh? Oh, because regular tumah is less stringent. But maybe when it comes to the tum'ah of the dead person, we're going to be more stringent and say even a string of hair from a goat can be mekabel tum'ah. So the answer is Talmud Lomar, beged va'or. That's why it has to say the words beged va'or with regard to tumat met as well. Beged va'or l'gzera shava. It says it twice. Beged va'or l'gzera shava. It says it both with regard to the regular tumah and with regard to tumat met. To tell you that whatever the definition of clothing is, with respect to one type of impurity is the same definition with respect to other impurity. Ne'amar beged va'or basheretz ve'ne'amar beged va'or bamet. It says beged va'or, it says clothing and skin with regard to sheretz, ordinary tumah. And it says the same thing with regard to the impurity of the dead. Ma beged va'or ha'amor basheretz lo timei ela tavoi ve'arig af beged va'or ha'amor bamet lo timei ela tavoi ve'arig. Just like we say with regard to ordinary tumah, that unless it's spun into thread and it's woven, it doesn't count as a beged, it doesn't count as clothing, and therefore it can't become tam'e from something else. So too, when it comes to tumat met even, we say the same rule. So uma beged va'or ha'amor bamet tame kol ma'ase izim, af beged va'or ha'amor basheretz tame kol ma'ase izim. And just like we said before, that when you have an item of goat hair, kol ma'ase izim is included. Even things which are not necessarily woven in the full way, but they're braided together, and even those things that are used for an animal to wear are going to be tame because it says kol ma'ase izim. All things made of goat hair. So too is going to, the same principle is going to apply to the tuma of a sheretz, to ordinary tuma. In other words, they learn back and forth from each other. So from tuma sheretz, we learn that even something that's not fully woven—I mean, that only something fully woven, or only something woven, I should say—counts. And we extend that principle over to the case of the dead, of tuma of the dead. And from tuma of the dead, we get the idea that kol ma'ase izim, even things that are made for animals to wear, are going to be subject to tuma. And we take that and we put that back. We take that same principle to ordinary tuma. So they share ideas with each other.
The gzera shava that they brought, are they assuming that the skin and hair have the same status?
Well, they're not. They don't really get into the or so much. They don't get into the skin so much. They're mainly focusing right now on the hair.
For between that.
Meaning that the same language beged or is used in both the phrase. Yes, that's the phrase. So the same language is used in both. So we extend. So there's a mutual gezera shava here, where we take an idea from sheretz, which is that it has to be woven on some level, and we put that on tumat met, and we take an idea from tumat met, which is kol maaseizim, which is that any ma'ase izim, even something that's made for an animal, is going to be subject to tumah. And we take that and we say that applies also to ordinary tumah. So we unify them. So enli ela devar haba min ha'izim, maybe that is only something that comes from a goat. But how do we know? Minayin lerabot devar haba mizanav asus umizanav hapara. What if you were to take the hair from the tail of a para? Of a cow. What if you were to take the hair from a sus, from a horse? Is that also the same rule, or is that not subject to tumah? Because it never mentions that.
It's included in the
set. Right. That's the question. How do we know? How do we know that? So Talmud Lamar Osak. We have the word Osak to teach us that any kind of coarse material, even if it comes from, in other words, generally, what is the main type of animal-based material that's used for clothing? It's usually the sheep hair, because of the wool. It's, you know, the wool is the highest quality. Okay, so using goat hair is already using something coarser. How do I know that even you, that's what the sackcloth comes from, right? The sack. Well, how do I know that even the hair from a para? Who uses cow hair? No, nobody. Who uses horse hair? No, nobody. But what if I did? What if I decided to use it? How do I know it would be good? Osak teaches you that any kind of coarse hair, even from a cow, and even from a sus, even from a horse, is going
to
be good.
Rabbi, yeah. Even the cover that you use for the bed to cover yourself from horse.
Mm-hmm. Horse hair, it's a beged, so it would be subject to tumah. That doesn't mean it's tameh. That means it could be subject to tumah if it touches something. So now, but wait a second, we have a problem. Because we used the word osak before. We used the word osak, if we look back up before, we used the word osak to teach us that the horse's clothing is included. So how can you use osak now to tell me that horse hair and cow hair is included? You already used it. So the answer is, so the Gemara asks, didn't you tell me before that that's to teach you, the word osak is to teach you, not to teach you that you can, that horse hair and cow hair are included, but to teach you that a horse's clothing made out of goat hair is included. So how can you use it for two things? So the answer is that now that we have, that was before we brought the gezera shava. Now, but now that we have the gezera shava, and we have this kol ma'ase izim, So we learn from Tumat Sheretz, we learn from the impurity, general impurity, the law, that it has to be woven on some level. We extended that over to Tumat Met, and we said that even when it comes to impurity of the dead, in order to contract impurity from a dead body, it has to be somewhat woven. And it says, Kol Ma'aseh Izim, with regard to the impurity of the dead. What do we learn from Kol Ma'aseh Izim? Even that which is used for a horse's clothing. For the straps that hold the saddle on, or whatever it is.
No, this is Osak.
So now we don't need Osak for that anymore. We were using Osak for that, but now we have a Gezerah Shavah. We can learn that from the word Kol Ma'aseh Izim. So we don't need the word Osak to teach you that. So now the Osak is free. So what are we going to use it for? To teach you that even the hair from a horse's tail, even the hair from a cow's tail, is going to be included in Tum'ah. So now we say as follows. So now the Gemara says, "Ve'en li ela b'sheretz," but that pasuk osak is only with regard to a sheretz, only with regard to ordinary tumah. B'tumat met minayin. How do we know that horse hair clothing can contract tumah even from a dead body? V'dinu, and maybe you'll tell me it's logical. Time b'met v'time b'sheretz. Ma kishit time b'sheretz. Asad v'arba miznav asus umiznav apara ki maase izim. Av kishit time b'met asad v'arba miznav asus umiznav apara ki maase izim. Maybe you're going to tell me what's the difference. Logically, what's the difference? I mean, tumah is ordinary tumah. If something contracts tumah from an ordinary source, like from a dead animal, which is only a one-day tumah, it's a much lesser tumah. So why shouldn't it contract tumah from a dead body? What's the difference?
It's not the difference. It's kal v'chomer.
It's kal v'chomer, or at least equation. At least right. An equation, right? At least an equation. So the answer is hen imhir ba bitumat erev shi mirube. That's not true, because or shehu miruba. So if you increase tumat erev, in other words, you're talking about increasing the category of things that can become tamei with regard to tumat erev. Shehi miruba, which is a very common tumah. People would become tamei tumat erev all the time. Tumat erev means a one day tumah. There are many types of tumat erev. You touch a dead animal that didn't die from shechita. You have relations, marital relations. It's a one day tumah. There are many ways the thing can become tameh for a one day tumah. It's very frequent. So there, since it's only a one day tumah, maybe we're more liberal and we'll extend it to more categories because it's only a one day tumah anyway. But does that mean narbe b'tumat shivashi mu'etet? Does that mean that a rarer tumah, which, such as the tumat met, which is more infrequent because it's a less frequent tumat and it's more stringent, are we necessarily going to expand that category? In other words, you have tumat sheret, which is a very common tumat, and because it's so common, it's also more limited in the amount of days, right? Because it's very common. There are many different ways you can become tameh from tumat sheret. But when it comes to tumat met, it's less frequent and it's a longer duration of tumah. Maybe we don't expand the category over there. So Talmud Lomar, beged va'or. Because we have this gezerah shavah, beged va'or. What does it teach us? Beged va'or, the gezerah shavah. Ne'emar beged va'or b'sheret, ne'emar beged va'or b'met, ma beged va'or b'hayam or b'sheret, asad dvar rabba mizinav asus, mizinav apara ki ma'ase izim. Af beged va'or hayam or b'met, asad dvar rabba mizinav asus, mizinav apara ki ma'ase izim. So the thing is that we have this gezerah shavah. And the gezerah shavah tells us that whatever applies, just like we're going to say that the hair of a horse and the hair of a cow is going to be mekabel tum'ah, in the framework of regular tumah, we're going to apply the same principle to tumat met. But then there's only one problem. We already used this gezerah shavah before. Didn't we just use this gezerah shavah before?
You mean just before?
In other words, we just traded ideas between tumat sheretz.
Well, they're using two different gezerah shavah.
I mean, we're using the word beged va'or again. We used beged va'or before.
After that, they used the gezerah shavah with a different language. They said
beged va'or, beged va'or, just like in sheretz.
So just like
sheretz, okay. It has to be woven. So too with tumat met, it has to be woven. And we said just like with tumat met, it could be any kind of ma'aseh izim, even a horse's clothing, the thing it holds a saddle on. So too when it comes to tumat sheretz. So we used beged va'or. So now you're telling me another thing in beged va'or, right? So now the Gemara says, and you have to say umufne. You have to tell me that this gezerah shavah, the words beged va'or, in Tumat Sheret and the words Beged Va'or in Tumat Met are free for a Gezerah Shavah. They have to be open. In other words, they're not being used for any other limud. De'ilav Mufne, because if they're not open, Ikal Mifrach, we can reject this equation. Because in other words, if you have a Gezerah Shavah that's an ironclad Gezerah Shavah, there's no way to go against it. There's no way to refute it. Then there's nothing we can do. We accept it. But if it's not ironclad, in other words, if you can interpret those words as meaning something else, and you're not forced to make a Gezerah Shavah, you're not forced to make an equation between the two categories, then we might be able to refute the equation. As follows, Mala Sheretz Shekin Mitamei B'Chadasha, because we could always say, you know what? Tumat Sheretz is stringent. It's more stringent than Tumat Met in one way, which is even a tiny amount, the amount of a lentil, is Tameh in Tumat Sheretz. Even the smallest, tiniest amount. With a mit, with a dead body, it has to be a kazayit. It has to be a larger amount of dead material to transmit Tumah. Of corpse, to transmit Tumah. But when it comes to regular, let's say, a dead Sheretz, only the amount of a lentil, a tiny amount, is all you need. So maybe that's also a stringency, just like you see that stringency, perhaps the stringency that horse hair is included and cow hair is included is the same. And it's limited only to Tumat Sheretz. So we have to show that this Gezerah Shavah is a necessary Gezerah Shavah. So, it is indeed true. Afnuye Mufne. It is available for us to learn from it. Why? Mechdi Sheretz, itkash l'shechvat zera dechtiv, ish shetetze mer shechvat zera, v'samech le'ish asher yiga b'chol sheretz. וכתיב בי בשכבת זרע בכל בגד בכל אור אשר יהיה לה בשכבת זרע או שכבת זרע actually. Okay, so beged va'or dekatav rachmana b'sheretz lamali. So what do we say? The problem is like this. We used beged va'or already before, right? So you actually need two mentions of beged va'or, because you need one to teach you in the case of sheretz that it has to be woven. Remember, we learned that from the words beged va'or, that it has to be woven. And we learned from the words beged va'or with regard to tumat met, a gezerah shavah already before. That's what we used them for before. So now the Gemara is saying, actually, we don't need to use it for that. Why? Because tumat sheretz is connected to the tumat of a seminal emission, of having marital relations. And that, shechvat zera, it says, beged va'or, already. And right next to it is the discussion of sheretz. So you don't really need another mention of the words beged va'or for sheretz, because it's already connected to shechvat zera.
In other words, it's specifically shechvat zera,
and it mentions beged va'or.
But shechvat zera as an example, or shechvat zera?
No, actually in the pasuk.
So specifically shechvat zera, but not touching a dead animal, or I mean a dead.
Well, no, they're right. They're connected to each other. In other words, the pasuk that mentions shechvat zera, and then it mentions tumat sheretz. They're right next to each other.
Which means to differentiate it to tumat met. In other words, that as opposed to...
That's a category of the regular tumat, right? The ordinary tumat. They're right next to each other. So since they're right next to each other, there's already an equation between tumat sheretz and tumat shechvat zera. And if there's already an equation there, and we know in tumat shechvat zera, the tumat of the semen tumat, that is a... That tumat, beged va'or, is already mentioned there. That it needs to be something woven. So we don't need that for Tumat Sheretz. So now we have the Beged Va'or in Tumat Sheretz is open to be learning, to teach us something else, to make another Gezerah Shavah. Because we don't need it. Okay, and what about on the other side? So now the Gemara says, okay, so Va'akatim Mufne Mitzadechadu, but still it's only free on one side. In other words, Shema Minal Afruye. So therefore we see, so it's beged va'or the katav rachmana b'sheretz lamali. So why does that say beged va'or with regard to sheretz? Shema min al afnuye. So it teaches you that it's open. So vakatei mufne mitzad echadu, but still it's only open on one side. Meaning that on the side of tumat met, you still need the words beged va'or. So that's hanicha lemanda amar mufne mitzad echad lemedin ve'en meshivin. In other words, we're assuming here, if you were to assume that as long as one side of the Gezerah Shavah is open, it's an ironclad Gezerah Shavah, that would be fine. But according to the one that says that both sides have to be open for it to be legitimate, in other words, it has to be clear that the words with regard to Tumat Sheretz are there for the Gezerah Shavah, are there to make the equation, and that the words in Tumat Mit are there to make this equation and nothing else, unless we have that clear, we're not gonna be able to show that this equation is a necessary equation. So what are we gonna do? Demet nami afnuye mufne. We can also show that with regard to tumat met, it's not necessary to have beged va'or to teach what we thought we needed to teach before. Because what we thought we needed to teach before was, we thought that we needed to learn from Sheretz that it needs to be woven, and we need to then take that idea that it needs to be woven and apply it to Tumat Mit. But now we said with Sheretz we don't need that. Maybe with Tumat Mit we also don't need that. Let's see. So it's Michti Mit, it's Kashta Shechvat Zera. Because Tumat Mit is also equated to Shechvat Zera on one level. Because in one Pasuk they're mentioned together. Tumat Mit, the impurity of the dead, and the impurity coming from semen. So therefore, Uchtiv Shechvat Zera v'chol Beged v'chol Or. Beged v'or Kata Rachman v'amit Lama Lish Mamin Al Afriyeh. Therefore, what do you see? That we don't need, in other words, we can learn the idea of Beged v'or for Sheret independently. The idea that it has to be woven. And we can learn the idea that it needs to be woven by Tumat Mit independently. Why? Because both of them are equated to Shechvat Zera. To the case of semen. Already, there's another equation. So therefore, mentioning Beged Va'or in the case of Tumat Sheretz and mentioning Beged Va'or in the case of Tumat Mit are both superfluous. Because we know already from the equation to the third case that only a woven garment is subject to impurity. So therefore, the words Beged Va'or in both cases, the fact that it mentions again Beged Va'or, clothing, in the case of impurity of the dead, and it mentions clothing, in the case of impurity contracted from a dead rodent, okay, must be for some other equation between the two. And therefore we have them both free, and we can make the equation between the two that horse hair and goat's hair are the same, and cow's hair are the same. In other words, that we're expanding the category that not only do we include goat's hair that's woven for into a coarse material for a person. Not only do we include that, but we extend that to include cow's hair and horse's hair as well. And then Osak can come along to tell us that that includes even the clothing that's made for the horse. So basically in the end what we have is the Gzera Shava is teaching us that cow's hair and horse hair is included in both cases, in both the case of impurity of the dead and in the case of impurity of the ordinary impurity. And we have the words Osak to teach us that not only is it a sack that's made for a person, but even a sack that's made for an animal to wear. Okay, so that's basically the bottom line, that we make these equations and we figured this out. And so the standards in the end for garment, for both impurity of the dead and for ordinary impurity, are the same. But the logistics that they had to get there were complicated.
Having two sides for the Gezerah Shavah, having both sides
open.
Available. Is that a higher level? I mean, what's the rule? What's the bottom line?
So there are two opinions. Basically, methodologically, there were two schools of thought. There was a school of thought that was more liberal that basically said that if one side is open, then you have to justify the need for that one side. So the fact that you have to justify it with the other side that isn't open doesn't matter. It's still justified. Right. The other side said no. Both. In other words, if Sheretz didn't need the words Beged Va'or, but Tumat Mit did need them for some for itself. It's used
way,
for some other thing.
Because it could be used for two different comparisons. But
so as long as one of the categories it doesn't have any purpose for having those words other than the comparison, the comparison stands because you need to explain it. But there's another view that says
it meaning for everybody.
Right, it could be stronger. There can be a stronger and weaker Gzeirah
Shavah. Gzeirah Shavah is something that is determined just by logic, or is that a transmitted tradition?
It seems like they had a tradition about which words that were part of Gzeirah Shavah, but they didn't always know how to interpret that.
Right.
That's for sure. Yeah, that's for sure. So now we say Vanakrevit Korban Hashem. We go to the story of the Milchemet Midian, which was touched upon earlier, that when they went to war against Midian and they brought back they came back unscathed. Nobody was lost in the battle, and they wanted to bring an offering to Hashem, and the offering was of various gifts of jewelry that they found in Midian. So it says, "Ish shematzak li zahav etzadav etzamit about agil v'chumaz." This is a list of various kinds of beautiful items that they found: bracelets and so on, rings. Amar Rabbi Elazar says, "Agil ze defus shel dadin." that the agil is the shape of the bosom of a woman. Unusual kind of a piece of jewelry to have. And kumaz ze defus shel bet rechem. And the kumaz is in the form of the private parts of a woman. Unusual kind of art that they had in the this jewelry that they had in Midian. So Amar Rav Yosef, Rav Yosef said, "I hachi haynu demitar geminan machoch." This explains why we call it machoch, davar mevile de gichuch, because it's something that leads to gichuch, which is levity. In other words, because it has a sexual reference. In other words, it was a very suggestive, like people have today, very suggestive sexual art. Apparently, they had these kinds of decorations back then as well. It's going to explain in a minute why they did that. So, Amar le Rabbah, Rabbah said, Migufei dekra shemamina. We can see it even from the word. Kumaz kan makom zima. What does kumaz stand for? Here is the place of illicit relations. Kan makom zima. That's what kumaz stands for. Vayiktof Moshe al pikudei achayil. Moshe Rabbeinu got upset with the commanders of the forces. Amar Rav Nachman bar Amar Rav Baravua. Rav Nachman said that Rabbah Baravua said, Amar lehen Moshe Yisrael. Moshe said to the Jews, Shema chazartem lekil kulchem. When you went to war against Midian, maybe you went lekil kulchem arishon, maybe you went back on your old ways and you were seduced by the ladies of Midian again. Right, because originally they sinned with the women. So he said, maybe you went and you sinned with them again. Amrullah, they said, lo nifkad mimeno ish. They said, nope, not one of us was lost. Meaning that one of us strayed midat Yehudit, Rashi says. In other words, our religion, lo nifkad mimeno ish, spiritually. We all stayed on the mission. We didn't stray after the women this time. So so he said to them, Amar lahen, in other words, Moshe, if somebody brings a gift offering, everybody suspects that they're guilty of something, right? So it's like the joke about the man who goes to the florist and wants to get flowers and the florist says, what did you do? Right? So the same thing. So Moshe Rabbeinu says, you're bringing a gift. What did you do? So if you didn't sin with the, so he says, did you sin with the women? Is that why you're bringing the gift? They said, no, we were good. So then what did you do? If so, Amar lehen im kin kapara lama. So then why do you need a kapara? What did you do wrong? Amrulo, they said to him, imi de avira yetzano, mi de hirulo yetzano. So it could be, even though we didn't do any sins, that doesn't mean we didn't think about it. Right, we still were attracted. We looked, you know, our eyes strayed, like Jimmy Carter said. You know, I lusted in my heart. Remember Jimmy Carter? He said, I never committed adultery, but I lusted in my heart. This famous Jimmy Carter. Okay, that's a famous interview that they did with him, where he said, I lusted in my heart. You know,
silliness.
Yeah.
His most famous silly.
Yeah, well, no, he's got more famous ones more recently. Yeah. Anyway, miyad vanakrevet korban Hashem. Immediately, it says they brought the offering. So Tana Dvei Rabbi Yishmael, Yeshiva Rabbi Yishmael said, "Mipnei Ma'ot Tzuchli Yisrael Shibotu Ador Kapara." What was the reason why the Jews at that generation needed a kapara? They needed an atonement. Mipnei, as we turn to Amud Bet, Mipnei Shezanu Enehem Mina Erva, because they enjoyed, they partook of the pleasure of looking upon the women. Yeah. So Amar Rav Shesh says, "Mipnei Mamana Katuv Tachshitin Bachutz Im Tachshitin Shebifnim." Why does the Torah mention? Because when the Torah mentions all the things that they brought back from Midian, it mentions Tabaat, Etzadav, Etzamid. All these things are things like necklaces and rings, normal things. And then it mentions these things that are made for the bosom of a woman, or these things that are made for the private part of a woman, that they were shaped that way, and they were jewelry that was placed in those areas. So why does it have that? So to teach you, lomar lecha, kola mistakel betzbak tana shel isha, kilo mistakel b'mkom haturpa, that anybody who looks at even the small finger of a woman, if his purpose is to enjoy her beauty in a sensual way, it doesn't matter. In other words, what it's saying is that sexuality is a very subjective thing. For one person, he likes to look at a woman's feet or her fingers. It doesn't matter. And so therefore, by putting all these things together, both the things that are reminiscent of the private parts or the very typically sexual parts of a woman, and the things that are just bracelets or necklaces, it's teaching you that whatever you enjoy, that's your own personal way of partaking of her beauty, it could be equally inappropriate. It's all in the eye of the beholder. Everyone's got their own thing that they're attracted to. Yeah, people are very particular in that way, and we know that there are, you know, some people have odd fetishes. Yeah, it could be anything. So the Mishnah, new Mishnah. Yotza isha b'chutei se'ar. Now we get back to Hilchot Shabbat. What can a woman? What can a woman wear out into the public domain in her hair? She can go out with chutei se'ar. She can go out with pieces of hair tied into her hair. That I guess they would have like hair weaves. It's like a hair weave. Ben mishalami ben mishal chaverta. Whether it is her own hair that has been removed and tied back in, or it's somebody else's. Ben mishal behema. Even if she has an animal's hair that was made into a wig or a type of hair weave and it was woven into her hair. Ubetotefet ubsarvitin. And similarly, a totefet, which is the plate that goes across her head, like totafot, and sarvitin are the things that hang down on the cheeks, as we learned before. So bezman shein tfurin, as long as they're tied to her hat. In other words, whatever she's wearing to cover her hair, they have to be tied and affixed on. If they're not tied on, if they're enan tfurin, then we have a problem that she might take it off in the public domain and carry it. But if they're tied on to her hair covering, then we're not worried that she's going to remove it when she's in the public domain. But kavul, she can go out with the kavul, which was the woolly cap that she put on her head. Upa'peya nuchrit lechatzer. She can go out with the woolly cap and peya nuchrit and a wig, but only to the courtyard, not into the public domain. We're going to see why. But she can go out, so there are certain things like the kavul and the peya nuchrit that she can only go out into the chatzer, into the courtyard, but not the public domain. Keep that in mind. She can go out with a cotton in her ear, which was to collect wax or whatever that would drip out of the ear. And if she has some kind of a cloth in her shoe because her shoe was hurting her foot, okay? So she would put some kind of pad inside the sole of the shoe because it's hurting her foot, that's okay. She can go out with feminine hygiene pad that she needs for her time of the month. She can go out with a piece of pepper. They would have some kind of pepper or some kind of piece of salt or something else that she would put into her mouth, which was for bad breath. If they had bad breath, they would put something in their mouth that would stay in their mouth. And I guess that they would be, you know, it wasn't considered obviously an ornament, and it wasn't considered something that she would take out and carry, but it was something, I guess, that would be held in the mouth and was for bad breath, to ward off bad breath. But she can't put it in her mouth on Shabbat. It has to be something that you put in before Shabbat, like you put on your tooth or you put on the side of your mouth and it stays in all the time. Not something that you put in on Shabbat and then go walk out. And if it falls out of her mouth, she can't put it back in. So it has to be something that's to stay there permanently, and if it falls out, it falls out. Shen totevet shen shel zahav, and a false tooth or a golden tooth, Rabbi Matir, Chachamim Osrim. Rabbi says it's okay to go out, and Chachamim say you can't go out with it. Now, of course, in those days, they did not have what we have today, which is that when you have a tooth that's placed in, it's, you know, when you go and you have like a filling, that's not what they're talking about. They're talking about a tooth that would cover over your tooth, like dentures or something that would cover over your tooth. Right. Anything that's actually attached permanently is not what they're talking about. They're talking about something that you would take in and out of your mouth.
So people can't go out now?
So dentures would be an issue, I suppose.
Or yeah. bridge work? Or
but that's something that's permanent. And it's not. Oh, if it's removable? I didn't know there's removable. Okay, so that might come under this as a problem. I didn't even know that existed. Nowadays, as the Tosafot says at the end of this Amud, there are many, you know, for various reasons, a lot of these practices sort of fell out of common observance nowadays. Women wear all kinds of jewelry into the public domain. Now, Rashi interprets this last phrase in the Mishnah in two different possible ways. Either that it's talking about the same thing, Shen Totevet Shen Shel Zav is the same thing, that it's saying a false tooth meaning a tooth of gold, or it's two different things, and shen totevet, everybody agrees is okay, and it's only shen shel zahav, it's only the golden tooth that the rabbis argue about. But an ordinary false tooth, the rabbis don't argue, because they would say nobody's going to take their false tooth out in the middle of the street. Maybe somebody would take their golden tooth out. But in the end, what?
Oh, that's right, only the golden tooth.
Yeah, only there. Right. Either it's only talking about the golden tooth, or it's talking about both, and it's actually permitting the regular tooth and only prohibiting the golden tooth. So now we say like this. The Gemara says, "Utsricha, we need all the cases, because in other words, the first case was the woman who has the hair weave, and she either has a weave of her own hair, of somebody else's hair, or of an animal's hair. Why do you need all three cases? Because if you told me only her hair, because she's not disgusted by that. In other words, it's not something unpleasant to have your own hair tied into your hair. I wouldn't know, but that's what I hear. But if it's somebody else's hair, she might decide she feels uncomfortable with it and take it out. And if it's her friend's hair, debat minahi, because at least she is a human being. But when it comes to an animal, you might say that that's why you need all three cases. In other words, we're not concerned to tell you that you might have thought, oh, she shouldn't go out with an animal's hair woven into her hair because maybe she's going to feel uncomfortable. She's going to take it out and she's going to carry it. The answer is that since these are woven into the hair, they're looked at as semi-permanent, and therefore we're not concerned that she's going to untie them in the Rishut HaRabim. Tana says, Tosefta ubevach lo tete yalda b'shel zekena uzkenem shel yalda. The only exception is an old woman should not go out with a young woman's hair tied into hers, nor should a young woman go out with an old woman's hair tied into hers. What's the reason? Because somebody might make fun of her, say, hey, what are you trying to do? You're trying to be a young woman tying that young woman's hair into your hair. Well, who are you trying to fool? And she's going to be embarrassed, and she's going to take it out in the Rishut HaRabim. So bishlam azkenem shel yalda shevachula. We understand why an older woman would put a younger woman's hair into her hair, because the older woman's hair is graying or turning white, and therefore she ties in some younger woman's hair to make her look a little bit more youthful. But why would we even have a case where a young girl is going to put an older woman's hair and tie it into her hair? Why would she want to do that? The fact is, really, that would never happen. Really, that would never happen. But since we wanted to illustrate the case of the older woman tying the younger woman's hair into hers, we also illustrate the opposite case.
True. Older woman would do that if she's going to feel embarrassed and take it out.
Well, maybe
anyway.
She's not sure. It's, you know, many times a person will go and be like, hey, I'm going to wear a toupee I'm bald, I'm going to wear a toupee for the first time. They show up and they realize they don't feel comfortable with it. You know, they feel embarrassed. Everyone's looking at them and they know it's fake, and you know, they decide to take it off. So we can imagine that happening, actually. And that's the kind of situation we're describing here. A woman was a little bit overzealous and thinking that she'd be able to hide her age, and she discovered halfway through that it didn't work too well. So we said that with wearing a woolly cap or wearing the pe'an uchrit, a wig, you can go into the courtyard, but you cannot go into the public domain. So Amar Rav says, actually, anything that you're not allowed to wear into the public domain, you're not allowed to wear into a chatzer either. What's the reason, Rashi says? Because even though you're allowed to carry in the chatzer because it's an enclosed area and you have an eruv chatzerot that we learned about, so therefore you're allowed to carry in the eruv in the chatzer, still we don't want you to make a mistake. Once you've already left your house wearing this item, there's a likelihood that you're going to leave the courtyard wearing the item as well. It's not like carrying. Carrying inside the chatzer, you know, when you leave the chatzer, you have to take everything out of your pocket. You're not allowed to carry it into the public domain. But if you're wearing something on your head, there's a possibility that you're going to wear it into the courtyard. You're not going to realize that you're wearing it, and you're going to wear it into the public domain. That's true for all of these things, except for the woolen cap and the wig. The woolen cap and the wig you're allowed to wear in the chatzer, even though you're not supposed to walk out of the chatzer of the courtyard into the public domain. Rabbi Anani Bar Sason, nice name. Rabbi Anani Bar Sason, Mishmeid Rabbi Ishmael, says in the name of Rabbi Ishmael, Amar Hakol Kakavul. All things are the same. Hakol Kakavul Tanan. Okay? I'm sorry, Hakol Kakavul. Everything is treated the same as the Kavul. In other words, just like the example is given in our Mishnah, that you're allowed to wear the woolen cap and the Pe'ah Nochrit and the wig in the courtyard, but not in the Rishut HaRabim, so too with all of the things that we've mentioned thus far, that you're not allowed to wear in the Rishut HaRabim, you're allowed to wear them in a courtyard where it's permitted to carry. You're just not allowed to wear them beyond that. So, Tanan ba kabulu ba pe'anukhrit l'chatzer. But it says in our Mishnah, only a woolen cap and a wig. Bishlam al Rav nicha. This makes sense according to Rav. Because what does Rav say? He says that the only things that are an exception are the woolen cap and the wig. Everything else you're not allowed to even wear into the courtyard. But according to Rabbi Anani Bar Sason, it's a problem. Because according to Rabbi Anani Bar Sason, why is there an exception here? So the answer is Rabbi Anani bar Sasson Mishmei de Man Kamar Le Mishmei de Rabbi Ishmael bar Rabbi Yossi. Rabbi Ishmael bar Yossi Tanahu Palig. Rabbi Anani bar Sasson is not saying his own opinion. He's quoting Rabbi Ishmael bar Yossi. Rabbi Ishmael bar Yossi is entitled to his own opinion. He's a Tana. And he holds that all of the things that the Chachamim prohibited us to wear in a public domain, we are permitted to wear in a courtyard. And therefore, he has a right to his opinion. Virav Maishinahanes. But now we have a different problem, which is, okay, now you reconciled us with the Mishnah. Our Mishnah is explicable according to Rav. Rabbi Ishmael Rabbi Yossi had a different view, and that different view is stated by Rabbi Anani Bar Sasson. One view is that anything that's that is prohibited to be worn into the public domain can be worn in a courtyard where it's permitted to carry. And the other one says, no, anything that is prohibited in the public domain can only be worn in the house, not in a courtyard. But except for the woolen cap and the wig. Those are the only things. So now we have a different problem, which is, why do you make an exception for the woolen cap and the wig? Where did that exception come from? Amar Ula Ula says, Kedei shelo titgane al ba'ala. Because we don't want a woman to become... to look ugly in front of her husband. In other words, to look unpleasant. Kedetanya, as we learned in a braita, v'hadava benidata. As it says, the woman who's in nida. Okay, the word nida is one of the meanings of the word nida is to be separated, right? To be separated. So what do we say? Zikenim arishonim amru shelo tichol velo tifkos velo titkashet v'bigdei tzivonim. The early rabbi said that a woman who's in the state of nida shouldn't do her eye makeup, and she shouldn't do her hair, she shouldn't put on flashy clothing. In other words, she should be unattractive so her husband is not tempted during that time. Ad sheba Rabbi Akiva, but then Rabbi Akiva came along and said, Beli medim kenatam migana al bala. What you're doing is going to make this woman displeasing to her husband. Her husband is going to be disgusted with her if she looks ugly. And then her husband is going to be turned off by her, and he's going to divorce her. What does it say? What does it mean when it says the dava, the woman who's having her period, benidata? What does it mean, benidata, in her separation? It doesn't mean that she has to look ugly. It means that she's benidata. She is in the state of separation from marital relations until she goes to the mikveh. But it doesn't mean that she has to look ugly. And in the same way, Rav says, this whole gezerah about women not wearing beautiful things into the public domain is very nice, but we don't want to prohibit her from wearing some basic ornaments, at least in the courtyard. Because we don't want her to be unpleasant to her husband, and therefore we permitted these two things as an exception to the rule. That's how he explains the Mishnah, why there's an exception. Amar Rav Yehuda, Amar Rav. Rav Yehuda said that Rav says, "Kol makom she'asu chachamim b'nei marita ayin, afilu b'chadrei chadrei masur." That we say that any place that the rabbis prohibited something because of marita ayin, for example, there are many examples, but one of the examples used to be eating, let's say, drinking fish blood is the example that the Gemara gives, because fish blood is not blood, it's not considered dam. So you're allowed to drink it. But if somebody's going to see you drinking something red, they think you're drinking blood of an animal. So you have to put some scales of the fish there so they see that it's fish blood, right? So what happens if the person is doing that b'chadrei chadarim in the privacy of their own home? Nobody can see them. They said, afilu b'chadrei chadarim asur. Even in privacy, you have to keep the rules of marita ayin. Right, but even privately, you have to. For example, if you would use almond butter and you're putting butter on your steak, you know, somebody says, why is Sammy putting... when margarine first came out, it was a big problem. Because nobody knew what is margarine, what it was. Or soy milk, people drinking milk, having a steak. People will see you and say, what are you doing? You know, so now everybody knows there's so many soy milk, so many margarines, everybody knows. There's more parev than dairy because everybody's getting away from dairy now. But in those days, that was a real concern. Even 25 years ago, 20 years ago, was a concern. So, but we learned, tanan, velo bizug afal pisha pakuk, that you're not allowed to have your animal go out with a bell, wearing a bell. What was the reason? Even if you plug up the bell so it doesn't make a noise, you can't. Because it looks like you're taking your animal to the market. So the Gemara, but Vitanya Idach, but we learned in another Braita, Pokek Lazug Bitzavara Umitayeli Mabachatzer, that you can walk your animal, as long as you plug up the bell so it's not making a sound, you can walk your animal around in the courtyard wearing a bell on Shabbat. So wait a second, you just told me that anything which you're not allowed to do because it looks bad, you're not allowed to do even in the privacy of your own home. And now you're telling me that you're not allowed to have the animal wear a bell in the public domain because it looks like you're going to the market, but you're allowed to have it wear the bell when it's in the courtyard. But then why should you be able to have it wear a bell when it's in the courtyard? If anything that's about appearances, you apply even b'chadrei chadarim, even in private. So what's the answer? Tana'ehi, actually it is a machloket tana'im. Titani, as we learned in a braita, shotchan b'chama, avalo keneged ha'am, Rabbi Eliezer, Rabbi Shimon, osrin. That this is a very famous case of a person who's walking home on Shabbat and they get soaked in a torrential downpour, their clothes get wet. Or they walk into a huge puddle. Whatever happens, they get all wet and they get home. So the problem is if you hang, you might say, I want to hang my clothes out on the clothesline. Because I want them to dry. I didn't wash my clothes. Did I wash my clothes on Shabbat? No, Hashem washed them. You know, they were washed in the rain. But I want them to dry, so I'm going to hang them. What will people say? They're going to walk by and say, hey, look, Matias, he washed his clothes on Shabbat. Look, I see you put him out on the clothesline on Shabbat. What kind of... Somebody just said you were Shomer Shabbat today. Right? But I saw you with your putting on the clothesline, clothes on Shabbat. So that's why it says, the first opinion said, Shotchan b'chama, aval lo keneged ha'am. If you want to put them in the sun, don't do it in a place where everybody's going to see. Put it on your roof or whatever, in the sun where nobody's going to see it. Because otherwise people will assume you washed them on Shabbat. But Rabbi Eliezer and Rabbi Shimon Osrin, they say even to hang it in a place where people won't see, you're not allowed to do. Because anything that the Chachamim prohibited because of Marita Ayin, that's the reason that they prohibited it. Marita Ayin is the reason. But even in a case where Marita Ayin doesn't apply, we still say that it's prohibited. In other words, they prohibited the action. You're confusing the reason they prohibited it with the prohibition. The prohibition was you can't hang clothes out on Shabbat. The reason was because they might see it, right?
If you have wet clothes, then what do you do with them?
So actually, you throw them in the bathtub. You're not allowed to hang them up.
You just throw them in the bathtub.
Yeah, the best thing is you throw them somewhere. But you can't hang them because it looks like you washed them. And that's a halakha even today. Even in your house, you're not allowed to do it. Yeah. You're not allowed to hang clothes because it's because even though nobody will see it, the rabbis prohibited that action because of Marita Ayin. Right. But once they prohibited the action, it's universal. Even b'chadrei chadarim, even in private, it's going to be prohibited.